He's going to have to make some very difficult choices. One of those difficult choices, does he want to put his freedom on the line not to cooperate? In other words, are we going to have to take him into custody for obstructing an investigation? We're going to need to take him back and do what we need to do to interview him.
Bodyguards, because of their association and close association to whom they're guarding, you know, they're privy to things being said, things being seen that they may normally keep to themselves, but in this situation could actually lead to an identification of a suspect or suspects. So bodyguards are a prime source of information.
So I don't know how you can say, how the police can say that that's not cooperation when they weren't even approached. They're just sitting in the waiting room.
And if they're willing to give information, then a detective who neglects going for that information is losing a lot of valuable leads in this type of investigation.
I was there in Vegas when he was shot.
It doesn't matter whether you're bodyguards or you're a housemaid or you're a butler, you're privy to information, which is crucial, and you may keep it to yourself, but at a certain juncture, these things become paramount, these things become crucial. The conversations that are overheard, the conversations that are had, need to come forward.
Frank was re-interviewed, and Frank was very much more forthcoming. In fact, he gave a lot of information that really helped as far as what we were looking at. It was quite obvious that that information pissed off some people, and people just kind of shut down as far as answering our questions related to that.
I was interviewed by LAPD. I was interviewed, obviously, with Las Vegas PD, and then also the FBI, yes. And I, you know, couldn't have told them any more than what I knew. And, you know, from what I had seen or from what I had heard, and that would have been it.
And Frank, why are you doing this interview now?
Because I've done a whole lot of interviews. And basically, it's to get the truth out there.
Yafufula was a name that a lot of people have thrown back in our faces that we were derelict in doing things. Yafufula was interviewed the night of the shooting. Yafufula gave a statement. People say we never interviewed him. He was interviewed. And the big thing is everybody says that he said he could identify the shooter. No, he did not. He never said that to us. He said he might be able to identify the driver. That is what he said. We tried to re-interview him. The problem was, this is a big country. People go wherever, you know, we don't have tracking devices on them. So we have to depend on people that we know we can get in touch with to try and reach out to him. Malcolm Greenidge said he could identify the shooter. We finally track him down to set up a re-interview, and he says, I'm not going to look at any photos because I can't identify them. Yeah, we got beat up in the LA Times over that. And I'm thinking, okay, put up or shut up, Ace. And, well, but again, Reggie Wright Jr. is the one that brought him to that interview.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain.
You know very little about Marion Shug Knight's partner in business. There are no pictures of this man circulating on the internet. He's a man in the shadows. That man's name is Reginald Wright Jr. Reggie Wright Jr. was a former Compton police officer. His record as a police officer was short and unremarkable.
Reggie Wright used to work for Compton PD, yes. I know he had some type of medical retirement running Wright Way Security. He was not working for Compton PD.
I have no relationship with Reggie Wright at this time, nor do I plan to. Reggie is not honest, and I want to leave it at that.
One of Reggie's problems was that Reggie didn't have the executive protection background that we all had. But the difference between, I would say, the team and myself and Frank is Frank and I would speak up about it. You know, we would say, hey, Reggie, you know, you should do it this way, and this is why. Or you should do it this way, and this is why. And I think he was so busy being the boss that his employees couldn't tell him how or what to do, when all we were trying to do was educate him a little bit in how you do this or how you do that regarding executive protection matters. And it was kind of sad to us because, like Frank said, we had such a tight team that Mr. Wright and us could have gone places. We could have did a lot of things. We could have made a lot of money together, but he was too busy not wanting to be educated per se on particular issues that we were well experienced in that he was not. But if it seemed as if myself or Frank were trying to tell him, you know, what he could or couldn't do, then he wasn't hearing it, and that was the end of that.
Reggie Wright Jr. had one asset that made a relationship with him even more attractive: his father. Reggie Wright Sr. was on the Compton Police Department's gang detail and is still employed by the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. His father's status as a conduit to the gang population may have given Reggie Jr. a unique first-hand relationship with the same gang leaders that knew his father.
If that's not a conflict of interest, I've never heard one.
I was told that normally Tupac wore body armor in public. He wasn't doing that, and the way it was put to me is that I guess he was told not to wear it. I don't know why.
Could Reggie Wright make that sort of call and use death row resources for that effort? Apparently so. In these court documents, we learn that Wright was not only the acting general manager for death row, but was also agent of record for death row records. These lawsuit transcripts also show that Wright had the authority of managing witnesses and financial arrangements on Knight's behalf. We also know that Wright had the off-duty police departments of Los Angeles, Compton, and Las Vegas at his disposal. Shakur was killed while Wright was in charge, and he was given a promotion when most security agents would not have a job.
I was fired. They fired me, and I collected unemployment. No, I'm kidding.
You did?
Yeah, I did. They fired me.
Yes, I did answer that question. I was
fired.
Yeah, I guess. You know, the way it went down was interesting, but
it was fired.
But yeah, I guess you could say that. I was done. Was fired or let go or however you want to put it by Reggie. After refusal of doing certain work with him after Pac's death, so that I probably was unemployed by Right Way within a month.
I'm gonna add something to that. We were also instructed to lie by Reggie Wright to Shug. And the reason we were instructed to lie was because Reggie Wright told us not to carry any weapons. Shug called a meeting. All the artists were instructed to come to this meeting, and certain security was invited. Prior to going into the meeting with Shug and all the artists from Death Row, Reggie met with us out front in his own meeting and instructed us to say certain things. And when I got into the meeting, it was a meeting based, the meeting was basically about what happened. And the artists were drilling security about what methods we had used and what were some of our tactics.
Shug wasn't even aware that I was still doing security. Reggie had taken me to another job that he was doing at a church, securing a church up in Inglewood from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m.
I looked around and no one said it. No one was speaking up for security. So I seen it was more, and I've been in these type of meetings before, even at the fire station. It's almost like similar to a political type meeting of far the higher, you know, of what was going on. So I was one of the few people that spoke up and said, wait a minute, we were instructed not to carry weapons. And none of the artists knew that. They didn't know we were instructed not to carry weapons that day. And it looked like Reggie wasn't going to say that information to them. So I spoke up and said, no, we were instructed not to carry weapons that day. And that's why no one in security, with probably the exception of me, had a weapon.
I remember Michael asking me, or telling me rather, I'm sorry, telling me that Reggie had told Suge that I was no longer working with Right Way Security. And I would have wondered what he would have done or how he would have felt to have known that I was still working for Right Way all the way up until the end of November.
The fact that Reggie Wright Sr. is a police lieutenant who apparently was involved in this case is the father of Reggie Wright Jr., who, as I understand it, was the head of security for Death Row Records, creates a huge conflict of interest. And the fact that that the elder, Mr. Wright, is referred to in the affidavit for the search warrant, I think in some ways would taint that search warrant. At a minimum, it should have been brought out in the body of that affidavit for the search warrant, the relationship between the parties. It would have been helpful for the judge reviewing that application or affidavit for a search warrant to know that.
The greatest lie the devil ever told was he doesn't exist.
Now Compton got involved because they brought detectives there and handed a Crips member to them who they thought had information, and Las Vegas police didn't interview him. They talked to him casually, hi, how you doing, that sort of thing, but they didn't formally interview him and did not name him a suspect and let him go into the night.
A man once said that people will believe a big lie sooner than a little one. And if you repeat the lie frequently enough, people will sooner or later believe it. That man was Adolf Hitler. This is an affidavit, a sworn statement written as a matter of record. It contains facts and sworn testimony. This affidavit was used to secure a search warrant in which 22 arrests were made.
As far as the affidavit and the officer's style of preparing it, some of them are narrative and some of them are a little bit more factually based with bullet points. It's pretty much up to the police officer as to how he wants to style, he or she wants to style the affidavit for the search warrant. But the bottom line is they have to swear that those facts are true. And judges, when they're signing search warrants, the search warrants that I signed when I was a judge, more often than not, it'd be at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock in the morning. And you read it carefully, and you question those officers. But at the end of the day, the judge signing that search warrant, yeah, he's got to trust the officer. He's got to trust that what's contained in the affidavit is correct, and what's contained in the affidavit is truthful. And if at some point down the road it's found to be not truthful or not correct, the fruits of that search that was born from the affidavit and the search warrant can be suppressed.
Well, if all your facts are based upon the opinion or assumptions of other individuals and you have no confirmation of that by other witnesses, then you're going to go back and you're going to put your affidavit together and you say, I am swearing to these truths that were given to me. And these truths may not be truth. They're only opinions and assumption. So the detective that is getting the information must be able to confirm or to have other evidentiary value to verify them as truth.